HDNet. Once considered a rising star in mixed martial arts, Gegard Mousasi has officially reached star status. Currently the Strikeforce light heavyweight champion, Mousasi has beaten some of the best in the business and beaten them decisively. At age 24, where does the dream catcher go from here? Muhammad Lawal prefers to be called King Mo, a name every bit as flamboyant as his style. Mo is a knockout specialist. In all but one of his wins, Mo has turned out the lights on his opponent. Despite his track record, Mo says he can't get respect, but claims his day is on the horizon. This week, a doubleheader. Gegard Mousasi and Muhammad King Mo Lawal are our guests on Fighting Words with Mike Straka. From HDNet, this is Fighting Words with Mike Straka. This week's guest, Gegard Mousasi and Muhammad King Mo Lawal.
Gegard Mousasi, welcome to the program.
Thanks for having me.
No problem. So you got a great record, awesome record, but more impressive than your winning record is how you finish opponents in the first round. Why are you so aggressive? Why is it so important for you to do that in the first round?
Well, basically, I don't look for the finish. Usually when you look for the finish, you don't get it. But I'm just trying to fight smart, and when they make mistakes, I capitalize on it. And of course, if you finish it early, you don't get injury, and they don't have chance to get you back, like with a punch. So the best thing is to finish it as quickly possible.
You know, one of the things that strikes me when you're inside the cage is you're very stoic, and you almost look bored. You know, you have sort of a look on your face like, yeah, okay, we're going to fight right now. Oh, you hit me. Oh, you better do better than that. In your head, what is going through your head?
Well, basically what works for me well is when I'm nonchalant. It works well for me personally. It makes me more relaxed. Like with Babalu, I was like, okay, I'm going to win this fight. With Sokoju, I was more like, oh, I need to do something. But it works well for me if I'm relaxed and calm, and I do the things better. I fight like it's a sparring fight and like in training, and then everything comes out much better than when I'm, oh, I need to punch him, oh, this one didn't hit. So it works better for me if I'm calm and, yeah.
Well, you mentioned Babalu and Sokoju, and at this point in your career, people are talking like you're one of the best pound-for-pound fighters in the world, and I know that doesn't mean anything to you. But when you have this level of competition, you're doing so well, does it become important for you to keep winning as your legacy?
Yeah, definitely. It puts more pressure, and when people come up to you for picture and autograph, then you feel like you don't want to disappoint the people that watches you. So it puts more pressure, but on the other hand, it makes you motivated to train because of the fans of the sport. You make you feel like you want to do better. So it works positive for me.
How did you become a fighter?
How I started? Mm-hmm. Well, my friend was saying, well, he had some kid in his class that was bothering him, so he said, come beat him up.
Where was this? In the Netherlands?
In Holland. Yeah, so me and my friend went, I threw him on the ground and some stuff. And we thought, okay, we're tough, we're going to do boxing. So that's how I started with boxing. But when I was 8, 9, I also did judo. I always kept, I've always been in two sports.
Mm-hmm. Now, when you started boxing, it was only about a year later you became the amateur champion in Holland. Why so fast? I mean, what do you think was the factor that made you so good so quickly?
There were a lot of like district champion, like South champion, and I won also the junior championship of Holland. But Holland is small, so you can become pretty easy a champion.
Mm-hmm. Do you think being too confident works against fighters?
No, being confident is always good, but you always have to have in your back of your mind like, okay, I have to take it seriously because anything can happen. So being confident is actually pretty good, I think.
Right now you live outside of Amsterdam, and reportedly you're going to buy a hotel and a restaurant or a place and really cater towards the student population there?
I want to try to invest my money in real estate, and it's a safe thing, I think. I know the economy is not that good right now, but it's a safe thing, and of course, you cannot fight your whole life, so I want to put my money away, so when I retire, I can do fun stuff.
Rumor has it you want to retire by age 30. Is that true?
Yeah, I already planned it out, so, yeah.
What happens if your plan doesn't work out the way you foresee it?
Well, before
I ask, what is your plan?
Well, basically, I want to continue for 1.5 years in lightweight. Of course, I need to win my fights before I consider going to heavyweight. If I win the belt in heavyweight, then I won 3 belts in 3 divisions. So that's a goal of mine personally. I don't do it for others, but it's something that I want to do. And so after that, I want to continue for a couple of years heavyweight, and I think I have proven myself enough then, and I've made enough money, hopefully.
Does it matter which heavyweight belt you have, whether it's Strikeforce or UFC?
Well, basically, I'm trying. I don't know how the future will go, but it has to be in a major organization, I think. It has to mean something, yeah.
What if, I mean, you're part of Team Red Devil. What if by the time you're ready to move up to heavyweight, Fedor has the belt?
Well, I think Fedor has retired till then.
You think he'll be retired by then?
I think so. I don't think it will continue much longer, but we're not going to fight each other, so we'll see how things go. But I think my time is after Fedor.
Would you rather be fighting for UFC?
Not at this moment. I'm very happy with Strikeforce. They take good care of me. I have options to fight in every other countries, in Dream, other organizations. I can box if I want to. So I have the freedom to do whatever I want. So far they treated me very well. So I don't have any desire to go anywhere else.
Do you think the level of competition is as good as it is in UFC at your weight?
There's a lot of fighters, UFC top fighters in UFC light heavyweight, but Strikeforce is building up. With they're working with Dream and One. There will be some new talents. Dan Henderson has so it's building up. It takes time, of course, but they always put on excellent, exciting matchups. So you cannot go wrong.
You say you're going to go for training with Georges St-Pierre. What do you think of Georges as a fighter?
He's one of the best, definitely pound for pound, and he puts everything so well together. It feels like he's unbeatable at this moment in that division. I don't see anyone who can defeat him. So training with him would help me a lot, and I hope I can make it difficult for his upcoming fight so he trains hard.
You know, when we look at mixed martial arts fighters, a lot of them have a lot of muscles, cauliflower ears. You don't have a lot of muscle or cauliflower ears. You don't even look like a fighter.
Yeah.
Do you find
I'm trying to build up some muscle.
You are?
Yeah. Because light heavyweight, I felt like I was middleweight, sorry. I used to go down a lot, so I was more...
Cut?
Yeah, cut. And, so now it takes time to be a solid light heavyweight, so I'm working on that. Hopefully we get more muscle.
What's your favorite television show?
I watch a lot. I used to watch a lot Married with Children back then, but now South Park, Family Guy, Friends, all the comedy shows.
Do you party a lot in Holland? I mean, it is known as a party town, Amsterdam.
No, I never go to clubs. I usually go with friends, hang out like pooling or bowling, or, I don't know. Stuff like that I enjoy much more than hanging out in a club.
You can get hurt bowling, you know.
Yeah. One time I was bowling and my pants got, ripped.
Yeah. Split your pants bowling?
It's a dangerous sport.
Very dangerous sport. What's your handicap bowling? Are you good at bowling?
No.
No?
No, but I'm average in all sports. So, yeah.
How about video games?
Yeah, I play that too. Now I play Call of Duty, Modern Warfare, I think. Mm-hmm. All my friends got the game. We play online, headphone and stuff like that. A little bit childish, but it's fun.
That's great.
Yeah.
When you came to America, I remember the first time I interviewed you about a year and a half ago, and there was a lot of expectation. People said to me, you're interviewing Gegard Mousasi. He's going to be the next best fighter in the world. And it hasn't been so long, and they're right. Do you feel pressure?
Yeah, a lot. I feel like I won't be able to perform well, and that people are gonna be disappointed. Actually, I still have it, but the pressure makes me train harder, and it keeps me motivated to keep the belt. So, in that view, it's a good thing.
How happy would you be if, at age 30, all of your dreams come true, mm-hmm. all of your plans pan out, and then you could retire?
Basically, I'm now training every day. It's all about the sport. So it would be nice to have something else to do. Like, fighting isn't everything. So then I want to concentrate on other stuff. But right now my goal is to win all my fights. And I don't want any distraction aside that.
Big Armistice. Thank you very much.
Thanks for having me. Thank you.
Still ahead, King Mo.
I'm not a robot. I can't be Fedor. You gotta make people want to watch you or want to love you. You know, you gotta love me or hate me.
Fighting Words with Mike Straka continues in a moment. Coming up, it's the hottest mixed martial arts show on TV. From MMA's biggest names to the most anticipated live events, see it all on Inside MMA, next on HDNet.
Girls Gone Wild is on the search for the hottest girl in America.
So what will it take to be the hottest girl in America?
There has to be a look. There has to be an innocence about them. There has to be an attitude.
This competition is going to be decided by you and only you, America.
My name is Svetlana. I'm the owner of this establishment.
Svetlana. Oh,
You know what I want? My wish to make everybody happy. Because I love all of you.
Americans don't know sex. That's why they come to the Russian girls.
I don't know if you know what we do here.
I'm assuming discreet pleasures for ladies. Cute little zipper bags for lady products.
It's not that.
Okay.
It's prostitution.
We not only offer sex, we also offer political consultation.
Who's that? Ahmed Yanjan.
Hang on.
But you're looking like bats with all this anti-Zionist rhetoric. It's so 1986.
I really think that you and I ought to do what we came to do.
I declare.
I am Lady of the Night and Day, depending when clients want
to. Stop!
Wow. I have 3 daughters, one for every kind of man.
Arousal.
Here to provide you with all your sexual needs at reasonable price.
That
it was fantastic.
And the crowd is chanting,
Zatana, Zatana, Zatana.
Fantastic.
Welcome back to Fighting Words with Mike Straka. This week's guest, Muhammad King Molawal.
In MMA, there are people who are journeymen, there are people who pay their dues, and then there are naturals. And I think our next guest, King Mo, safe to say you're a natural.
Hey, you know, things come natural, some things don't, but fighting's always been in my blood.
It's only been a year and a half since you've been fighting professionally. You made your debut in Senkuku 5, and that's where you got that piece of hardware there, didn't you?
Yeah, man. You know, I follow the stereotype, and after I beat Travis View, had to go get me a chain at DQ Jewelry down at Big T Bazaar in Dallas. Had to get one.
Got the plug in.
Yep.
That paid for it right there.
Yeah.
So, obviously, you like the spectacle. You got the trademark towel on the head, the sunglasses, the hardware, and you make some great entrances. How important are those entrances to you?
Well, you know what? The entrances to me, it's just like another warm-up. You know, backstage, when I'm warming up, I only warm up for like a round because I hate warming up. If I could go out there and just fight, I would, but I warm up just to get my blood running. And then when I go to the ring, that's just a whole nother, loosens me up, keeps me warm. My timing, my footwork, the dancing, all that, keeps me relaxed, you know what I'm saying?
What are the differences between the Japanese audiences for MMA and the American audiences?
Oh yeah, let me get down to business for this one. See, this is a good one, it's a good question. The Japanese audience tends to be, they're more patient, more knowledgeable, and they're more respectful in a way. Not to bash the American crowd, but a lot of Americans, you know, think that MMA is just easy. You know, a bunch of guys in the cage just throwing punches. They don't respect the ground game, or if it's not enough ground game, you know, they want to see more slugfest. They want to see Stephen Bonner versus Forrest Griffin, or, you know, Cyborg versus Melvin Manoff. But, you know, I'm all about, you know, tactics and technique, you know, and that's what the Japanese like to see.
it's kind of ironic, somebody who's only been training MMA for a year and a half talking about technique.
Well, the technique, coming from a wrestling background, I had great coaches like John Smith, Kevin Jackson, my high school coach Alan Koepke, David James. I had a bunch of great coaches, and they stressed technique. Because if you have proper technique, it makes the matches that much easier and it conserves more energy. And you know, where some guys tend to, you know, muscle and overpower things, they end up fading. And when they wrestle a person or compete against a person with better technique, they fail and end up losing. So I feel like being technical to your style is very good because it helps you win.
You want to be the best MMA fighter in the world, don't you?
Yes, the best MMA fighter in the world, hands down.
You hear these phrases like, a fighter's got to sell fights. What does that mean to you?
You know, I think that means you got to show your personality. You got to make people want to watch you or want to hate you or want to love you. I'm not a robot. I can't be Fedor. Fedor has something that a lot of people don't have. He has a great winning record and knockout power, and he just is a robot. You know, if everybody was like that, MMA would be a dead sport and no one would be interested in the, you know, you have to, you know, no one would be interested to watch it. You have to have guys you hate. And I know a lot of people hate me, a lot of people love me. It's either, you know, you gotta love me or hate me. And that's one thing that's very important. You see them boxing and you see them pro wrestling, and MMA, I think, needs a lot more of that as well.
When you make a flamboyant entrance, do you ever worry about embarrassing yourself?
Yeah, you know, I worry about that because
the only way. You do, really?
Yeah, because I don't want to be offbeat. You know what I'm saying? I want to be looking smooth and cool and calm. I can't be choppy like that. You got to be, you know what I'm saying, and hitting the dougie and everything. You got to be fresh. You know what I'm saying? You can't be choppy. And I want to go out there looking smooth and silky. So when I come fight time, I'll be smooth and silky. But if you go there choppy and looking offbeat, come fight time, you might be choppy and offbeat and get embarrassed as well.
The light heavyweight division is probably, arguably, one of the deepest divisions across all of MMA. Where do you rank yourself?
Well, you know, I don't know where rankings fall, because if you ask anybody at 205 who's the best, they'll say themselves. And if they don't say themselves, then they probably need to get out the game. I feel like if you're a fighter, you should believe you're the best, or you're trying to be the best, because the moment you stop thinking that, you know, you're not the best, then, or you're not trying to be the best, then you might as well step out the game. So rankings mean nothing to me, you know. They're good for the general public to like grasp like to who to look out for, but at the same time, anybody can lose, because there could be a guy out there with a 1-896 record with 3 draws, and he can mess around and catch Fedor. You never know. I mean, rankings mean nothing.
What was your childhood like?
Childhood, you know, it was single parent household, you know. I was the oldest. My daddy was never around, pretty much. And when he was around, he was never good to me or my mama. My mama's from Nigeria, so she came to this country and raised us like how she knew, you know. And just, it was kind of, you know, we didn't have everything we needed, but my mama made sure she, you know, she did her best to make sure, you know, we weren't starving or anything. And I was the man of the house. And it's just, you know, everybody's the same story, you know, pretty much. You know, so it's just, I just overcame certain things and made this far where some people I was cool with, they didn't make it because they just got distracted. Mm-hmm. But I kept, you know, I had maintained tunnel vision and just kept moving forward.
Is fighting therapeutic for you?
Yeah, fighting is very therapeutic. Fighting and listening to music and dancing, all that's very therapeutic. I love to fight. And, you know, ever since I was young, my goal was to be the toughest dude in the neighborhood. You know, when I was young, we had a dude named Benji used to come through. And we had fight day. And fight day is pretty much when he came through, he'd point, look at you and be like, you're fighting him. And if we didn't fight, he's beating us up. So we'd be playing football, Benji roll up on the bike, stop, take the ball and be like, Mo, you fighting so-and-so. And that's how it was, man. You know, we fought.
Was Benji tough himself?
Oh yeah, he was big. He was in seventh grade while the rest of us was like in first. He pretty much, it was like Gladiator, you know what I'm saying? Like he got two of us to fight and then he gave us a thumbs up or thumbs down. You know what I'm saying? And if we didn't fight, man, he beat us up.
And so, he was in seventh grade?
He was seventh grade. He was big too, from what I remember. I used to do some stupid stuff with him. Like one time, like this dude had cookies. His mama bought some Girl Scout cookies. You know what I'm saying? Those mint thins.
Yeah, thin mints.
And, you know, thin mints, yeah. And he saw him eating them. And so he knew they're in the house. So like, he was like, Mo, come with me. We're gonna break in this house and take those Thin Mints. So we broke in the crib and took the cookies, though. I'll never forget that. It was crazy, but he forced me to do stuff that I didn't want to do, but, you know, he helped me out, you know what I'm saying, by getting tougher.
You said you're not a welterweight, you're not a light heavyweight, you're a money weight. What's that mean?
Money weight is, you know, a person like Dan Henderson's a money weight. Anderson Silva's a money weight. I'm just trying to follow in their footsteps. They fight where the money's at, not per se, but if there's a fight at a weight class and they want to take the fight, they'll fight at that weight, regardless. They want to just get paid, you know what I'm saying, and fight whoever. And that's what I'm going to do. If they need me to fight at 185 and it makes sense, hey, I will cut down to 185 if it makes sense.
You say you like music. What's your favorite music you listen to?
I like rap from the South. Texas, Louisiana, Memphis, you know, /Tennessee, and I got Georgia, you know what I'm saying? I like pretty much rap from them states.
You ever see the movie Hustle and Flow?
I loved Hustle and Flow. It was a great movie.
It was a good movie, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was a great movie, yeah.
It's hard out there for a pimp.
Yep. It's hard out there for a fighter.
It is hard out there for a fighter, isn't it?
Yeah, it really is.
How do you make it easy?
By just relaxing and having fun. Because the moment you start having fun, that's when everything gets hard and you start getting burnt out. You start having, you know, stop wanting to fight. You know, you want to do other things. When you're having fun, you're winning. Regardless if you win or lose, when you're having fun, you're winning. And that's what I try to do, make everything fun. It's not always serious, because when it's too serious, you just get burned out.
You've been dominant, and you haven't really used your wrestling much. So what do you say about that?
I used my wrestling a few times, you know, Mark Kerr, Fabio Silva, and Kyle Mora. But the thing is that it's give and take. Like, you know, if you're worried about my striking, I'll go for a takedown. If you're worried about my takedowns, I'll throw punches. Then if you're worried about both, then it's over. If you worry about both, then I'm going to win, and it's going to be an easy night for me, bad night for you. You know, I just go out there and I just flow and try to see what works.
What's your mama think of this career?
You know, my mama, she made a tough man because she used to beat me. No one could beat me worse than my mama did. And now she watches it, and she's like, first she didn't like it, but now she, you know, she's like, all right, you know, just go out there. As long as you're training hard, then, you know, you do what you want. But if you're not training hard, then get out the game.
All right, King Mo, thanks very much, man.
Thanks for having me.
This has been an exclusive presentation of HDNet.
Coming up, it's the hottest mixed martial arts show on TV. From MMA's biggest names to the most anticipated live event.